Well, good morning and welcome. It's good to see that you remembered to change your clocks, or I forgot, but thankfully Apple makes their phones remember for me. So it's good to see you all this morning. Welcome to our Lord's Day worship service. If we've not met, my name is Ryan. I'm one of the pastors here, and we're glad to have you here worshiping with us today. We have a lot going on this month and next, and I want to highlight a few announcements for you before we begin our time of worship. First, if you signed up to attend the Finding Jesus in the Storm meeting, we are meeting today at 12:30 p.m. upstairs in the fellowship hall. We'll eat lunch together before the talk, so just a reminder, make your way upstairs afterwards for that meeting. Also, at the end of the month, we're having a Good Friday service on March 29th at 5:30 p.m. here in the chapel. And then, of course, on the 31st, that's Resurrection Sunday. And we'll have a brunch during the 9 o'clock hour, so no discipleship hour or Grace Kids. We'll join, gather upstairs for a meal, and then the worship service at 10:30. Lynn Kaser is organizing the brunch, and so if you want to help out in some way, to bring food and so forth, please talk to Lynn. Lynn, could you just slip your hand up? There's a sign-up table out front as well, so she would really appreciate you signing up and letting her know who's planning to bring what. Also, we've been announcing an event, a church-wide training event, Safeguarding Our Children. And so Umberto is going to come and tell you a little bit more about that today.
Good morning. All right. So let's see. So yeah, so I'm here to announce the church-wide Safeguarding Our Children training. It's on Saturday, April 6th from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. And we know that, I at least know that the proper and sacred purpose of Saturday mornings is for freshly brewed coffee and bacon. But I think this would be a good time to make an exception to that rule. So just for some context, I in particular and Tom have been working with Grace for the past about year, and they started out by helping us with reviewing our policies specifically related to Grace Kids and nursery. And the next items were two trainings, one of them for our pastors, leaders involved with Grace Kids, and then the second one involving our entire church. And so one of the things that I've realized is just we want to make sure that we want to involve as many people as possible. So we'd like to invite not just parents with small children, but really the entire church. One thing I've realized is that it's really key for the entire church to be involved and to think about just how we can protect the most vulnerable among us. And so I think it'll be encouraging. I think it'll be a good way for all of us to think through just these topics. Let me look at my notes here. One thing I do want to clarify, this isn't, we aren't doing this due to any particular incident or anything. This is just out of an abundance of care from the elders to think through how to care for the most vulnerable among us, especially our children. In regards to the actual event, we are encouraging for those parents who have teenagers, we're leaving it up to the discretion of the parents whether they want to bring their teens. One thing we want to leave clear is that while there won't be any graphic content or anything like that, Mike, the director who will be speaking, he's great, and he will be speaking to the issues very frankly and very poignantly. So we're leaving it up to the discretion of the parents whether they want to bring their teens. What else? For those of you who will not be able to make it, we will be recording the event, so it will be made available afterwards. But we do want to make sure that as many people as possible can come, just because it is, it's also, even just if you have a question that you want to bring up to Mike in between the breaks, it's really, Mike is a really approachable guy. He's really knowledgeable on the subject, so that's a great opportunity as well. There will be lunch provided. And one thing we want to make sure is that you look at page 15 in your bulletin, and you can scan the barcode on your app to sign up and let the church know that you'll be coming, I believe. And you can, we encourage you to just to read that for more information. And you can always come to either me or Tom, and I believe Ryan as well, but me or Tom if you have any other questions or any other information you want. I think that's it, and so I'll hand it back to Ryan.
And then one final thing to be aware of, we have our partners in missions with us today, the Weaver family. So Rob and Joy and their kids. Rob and Joy shared during the discipleship hour about their work in Morrison, Ontario, Canada. And Rob will be preaching today in our worship service. So we're very happy to have the Weavers here with us and for this opportunity to reconnect with them, and then also to have Rob bring the word to us this morning. So looking forward to that. Now we're going to turn our attention to the call to worship. And today's call to worship comes from Psalm 99. We're going to read verses 1 to 3 together. I'll read the light print, and then please join me on the bolded print. And if you're able to stand, please stand. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. Let me pray for us. Our Lord and our God, we do indeed praise your holy name this morning. You are exalted in majesty and glory, and we bow before you today in worshipful devotion. And you, Father, are always more ready to give your good gifts to us than we are to receive them. You're more willing to give than we are even to desire or ask for them. And so, Father, we pray that you would pour out your grace upon us today. Would you thrill us with your mercy and your love? It's through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Let's join our voices together now as we sing praise to our God. We'll begin with All Creatures of Our God and King, and then Behold Our God.
With golden beam, thou silver moon with soft Please be seated.
Good morning. This morning's scripture reading is taken from Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. In the bulletin, it's page number 7, and on the Pew Bibles, you'll find it on page 980. Philippians 1, 3 to 11. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all, because I hold you in my heart. For you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. May God bless his word to us this morning.
Let's pray together. Our God and Heavenly Father, we come before you today in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, your Son. And gracious God, we confess that we've sinned against you, we've sinned against our neighbors in thought, in word, and in deed this past week. And we've been deaf to your call to serve others as Christ has served us. We've not been true to the mind of Christ. We've grieved your Holy Spirit. We ask that you would have mercy on us, Lord. We pray that you would forgive us for the sake of Jesus Christ. We take great comfort, Lord, in knowing that you are a God who delights in steadfast love. We thank you for your promise to cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. And so we ask that you would empower us today to live as forgiven people, both now and in the week to come. Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have to fellowship with the Weavers today and to enjoy their presence, their fellowship, their testimony of your faithfulness to them. And we thank you for your faithfulness to them over many years. We thank you for their steady trust in you and their love for the people of Morrison. Father, we pray this morning for Rob and Joy. We pray for Abby and Sam and Jude and Micah. Would you continue to uphold them with your love and your grace? We pray also for our friends at Dayspring Church in Reno, Nevada. We thank you for their faith in Jesus Christ and ask that you would direct their hearts to your love and to the steadfastness of Jesus Christ. We lift up the Maxims, Tom and Patty and Nevin, to you as they've traveled to Uganda. We pray that you keep them safe, keep them healthy. We ask that their time there with our brothers and sisters in Uganda would be very fruitful and bring them safely back to us. Our Lord and our God, we pray this morning for all among us who work in medicine, in education, in law, the sciences, government, business and industry. We pray for those who are beginning a new career, for those who struggle in their work, for those who are seeking new or different jobs, for those whose work is not valued or appreciated. We pray that you would give them joy in their work. Give them joy in using the gifts and the talents that they've received from you. Give them joy in doing all their labor to your honor and glory. And we ask that you would equip them to labor in ways that promote peace and the common good. Lord, we ask you to look with compassion on all among us who suffer. We pray that you would support them with your love. And we think of those with incurable diseases, those who are mourning and grieving. We think of families that are divided, those whose minds afflict them. We ask, Lord, that as you've moved toward us in love, that you would lead us to come alongside them in their suffering. And also, Father, we ask that you would strengthen this congregation in its work and worship. Would you fill our hearts with your self-giving love so that our voices may speak your praise, so that our lives might conform to the image of your Son. We ask that you would nourish us today with your word and ordinances so that we might bear witness to the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, both with our words and through our lives. And so, our God, we ask that you would accept all these prayers that we've offered today in Jesus' name. Give us strength to wait patiently for your answers. Help us to live faithfully in response to your call. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Would you please stand if you're able and join us as we sing A Christian's Daily Prayer. Seated.
I send greetings from the saints at Morrison Community Bible Fellowship. I also send greetings from my own family. We're thrilled to be here. We want to thank you for your prayers, love, and support. In many ways, we feel like fish out of water in Southern California, but we feel right at home with you. So thank you for welcoming us and loving us. Please turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 11, verses 19 to 30. I realize you have it in your bulletin as well. The book of Acts shows rapid church growth from 120 believers in chapter 1 to thousands and thousands, and they're mostly Jews. Now, if the gospel of Jesus is for all nations, we should hope the church would reflect people from Jewish and Gentile backgrounds and cultures. Yet thus far in Acts, there's only a few individual Gentile believers. The Ethiopian eunuch, and Cornelius with his household. Just a few. The apostles weren't spearheading any mission effort to reach the Gentiles or other people groups. But one of the themes of Acts, and it's kind of in the background, but it's very prominent, is that Jesus, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, carries the Great Commission forward. In these verses in Acts 11, Luke shows us a new church plant in Antioch. The city wasn't that close to Jerusalem. The Antioch church will be connected to the main church in Jerusalem, but it's going to be quite independent. It will also have both Jewish and Gentile believers. And in these few verses, it'll be really exciting to see how rapid this church grew and then how they matured and became generous. It's also exciting to see how Saul, powerfully converted in chapter 9, is brought to this church to help the church grow. Now, these verses aren't really about how to have a healthy church. I picked the title because I'll make a few applications of that are marks of a healthy church. And there are only some because much more could be said. Let's read Acts 11, beginning at verse 19. Now, those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. The report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people, and in Antioch the disciples were first called Christians. Now in these days prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. This took place in the days of Claudius. So the disciples determined, everyone according to his ability, to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. Let's pray for a moment. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. And we ask that you would open our eyes to see the truths in it, that we would see Christ, that you'd apply these truths to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Antioch was a very important city in the Roman Empire. Some people say it was the third most important city behind Rome itself and Alexandria in Egypt. But it wasn't exactly a great moral place. The Romans viewed it as a cesspool of vices. And from a human perspective, we wouldn't think that a church could be planted and then rapidly grow to so many people. There were many Jews there, and that always was a way to kickstart a church. You had people that might believe in Jesus. They were the most likely to convert. Now, who started this church? Luke says it wasn't from those who were scattered during the persecution after Stephen's martyrdom. These Jews who were scattered did go outside of Israel, pushing north and east, but they preached only to Jews. They followed a limited version of the Great Commission by only going to Jews. After all, Gentiles were harder to reach, and they were unlikely converts. I think there's an application for us right here. Don't count anybody out. Don't necessarily go to the easy ones. God can do his work anywhere and with anyone. So these church planters were simply unnamed believers from the island of Cyprus and Cyrene in Africa. We don't even know who their names are. They're not apostles. They're not prophets. Just unnamed believers preaching the gospel. And the power of God was with them as many Gentiles turned to the Lord. It's really obvious. God is with them. The hand of the Lord was with them. So what did the church in Jerusalem think about this? What did they think about so many Gentiles coming to faith? What did they think about these unofficial evangelists starting a church? Well, we know the answer. because the church sent Barnabas, not to condemn what's going on, but to encourage God's work in Antioch. You see, God is the main actor in the book of Acts. He used Peter to reach Cornelius, you know, some of the first Gentile converts. Here he uses nameless believers. And sometimes church leadership can be jealous of non-ordained people spreading the gospel and growing the church. Instead of jealousy, there should be rejoicing at the work of God. And the power isn't in people. The power is in the Word of God. I'll paraphrase a little bit. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 6. Some people plant, some people water. God makes it grow. Well, this church is growing like crazy. Barnabas is kind of the only leader that we know of that's named. They're going to need help. And Barnabas goes, and just thinking about the Jerusalem church, sometimes people think of the Jerusalem church as the mother church. Okay, they're making everything happen. They're sending. No, they're not. They didn't spearhead any mission effort. It's obvious that the apostles weren't really following the Great Commission. They weren't going beyond the Jews. It was all about God doing the work. But we do know the Jerusalem church was the most established. It's the only one that's been mentioned up till now in the book of Acts. And Barnabas, he wasn't from Jerusalem. Yet he became a leader in the church. He sold property and gave the proceeds to the apostles. Later, he defended and sponsored Paul when he came to the Jerusalem church. See, people were afraid of him. He was leading the charge on the persecution. But Barnabas was the guy who's like, no, I'm going to introduce Saul to everybody. For Barnabas, when he arrived in Antioch, he saw what God was doing. He saw evidence of God's blessing, and he lived up to his nickname, Son of Encouragement. He encouraged the believers to stay true to the Lord. We're not told, but it's likely that Jews were opposing these new Christians. It happened in almost every place Paul went later. So it probably happened here. Now Barnabas, he didn't require anyone to be circumcised. The New Testament sign is baptism. Luke described Barnabas as a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and strong in the faith. He was the exact fit of a guy to send to Antioch. Because he didn't grow up in Jerusalem or Judea, he knew Greek culture, he was bilingual. He could work really well in Antioch, and he sure did. He didn't criticize the new believers either, or those who carried the gospel to the city. In fact, he shows up, he's encouraged, he encourages the people, and even more come to the Lord. So there's an application for us. As disciples, stay true to the Lord. When we decide to follow Jesus and be baptized, the devil ramps up his effort to cause us to fall back into our old way of life. Don't think the Christian life is the easy life. It's difficult. It's the narrow road with few on it. But don't think of the sinful life as the easy life either. It's troublesome, fraught with pain and failure, and it lacks true joy. Simply, we could say the way of the sinner is hard. Well, Barnabas can't do this alone. The growing church, the discipleship needs are only increasing. He went to Tarsus to find Saul and bring him back to help him teach. This would be a few-day journey for him. But the word he used is unusual. He's looking for Saul. The only other place this word is used in the New Testament is when Jesus' parents were frantically looking for their 12-year-old son. If you have a child, now 12 years old is borderline to some maturity, if you can't find him or her, you know the pulse goes up, the panic meter starts to go, frantically looking. They had a hard time finding Jesus. He was in the temple. What about Saul? Where is he? Saul's been off the radar. We don't really know what he was doing in his hometown. He may have been rejected, disowned by his family. It's probably true. Barnabas had a hard time finding him. Where is this guy? Scholars think this was about 12 years after Saul's conversion. So Barnabas, feverishly looking for him, because he believed Saul was the right man for the Antioch church. Dr. Sinclair Ferguson said, Barnabas had the spiritual ability to see God's hand at work and put the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle together. So why Saul? Well, a couple reasons. He understood Jewish and Greek culture, and he would be an excellent fit to teach the people of Antioch. And together, we're told, Barnabas and Saul made this dynamic teaching duo for a year. But there's another element of why Saul was important. Barnabas, we're told, was a godly and humble man. Saul had gifts that Barnabas did not. And what's going to happen? Barnabas' choice of Saul is going to lead Barnabas to become second fiddle. Saul will rise to prominence and become the main teacher. And in Acts 13, Luke switches the names. He turns it around. It's no longer Barnabas and Saul. It's Paul and Barnabas. So while Saul and Barnabas were in Antioch, Luke tells us the believers were first called Christians. In the ancient world, there were only two groups of people, Jew and Gentile. And now we have this growing third group of people. What should they be called? Christians. Now, we're not sure just who used that name first. The label Christian may have begun as a derogatory term, a nickname to show contempt. And strangely, the label Christian is absent from early Christian literature, which may suggest it wasn't used by Christians for some time. But other people say, no, the believers chose the name for themselves. Whatever it was, in time, the name stuck. And now people know what Christians know, the label Christian throughout the world. So what is a Christian? I think there's two ways we can define it. First of all, it's a sense that we belong to Christ. We are Christ's ones. This, of course, comes by faith in him. But there's also a sense that we follow Jesus, that we live the way he lived. We follow his way of life. So Paul, Barnabas, they're teaching away. Church is growing. The disciples are growing and maturing. They're called Christians. And then something happens. They get to a point where they can show a level of maturity. And this came about through the prophets who came from Jerusalem to Antioch. At this point in the book of Acts, there's four groups of leaders. You have the apostles, the elders who are local leaders in a church. And then in Acts 6, there were servants chosen to help with practical needs. And here we're told there's prophets who had divine revelation for churches. So during a church meeting, the prophet Agabus stood up, gave a prediction of a famine coming to the entire world. And it was a true prediction because Luke says it came during the time of Claudius. I mean, there's a sense that it came true. It was fulfilled. So the believers need to decide what to do. Agabus didn't say, well, here's what you do. The believers had to decide. What does God want us to do? How can we bless those in need? If you knew a famine was coming, what would you do? Let me ask you another question. What happens when a so-called prophet makes a prediction today? What's the response? Hoarding. Stock up. Add more ammunition. Get ready for doomsday. Tends to be selfishness. Look what the Antioch church decided to do. Let's send relief to the believers in Judea. Everyone giving as much as they could. And I think Barnabas' leadership shined here. He's been so generous before, and now he's encouraging the believers to be generous. Each gave according to his ability. Now it seemed that the believers in Jerusalem had been suffering ever since the persecution broke out after Stephen's death. They suffer again and again and again, and even on Paul's missionary journeys, he's collecting money from all these mostly Gentile churches to bring money to the believers in Jerusalem. So the disciples gather the gift. Barnabas and Saul bring it, not to the apostles. There's a difference here. They bring it to the elders. Elders are becoming the main leaders in the church. And of course, the apostles remain the apostles over all the churches. I do want to make an application about prophets. A church needs a teacher, sometimes several. By Acts 13, the Antioch church has 5 prophets and teachers. We're not told exactly which titles for who, but prophets were part of that ministry. And they would interpret and preach God's word, encourage the people, and at times they predicted events. They differed from Old Testament prophets because their ministry was looking ahead to Christ. Now, with New Testament prophets, they speak of Christ as he's already come. And they also, like Old Testament prophets, do speak of future events. They're secondary to the apostles, for the apostles spent time with the Messiah. But when it comes to prophets, God encourages us to be discerning. This is something from the Old Testament. Deuteronomy 18, verses 18 to 22. Moses wrote, "I will raise up for them a prophet like you among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that same prophet shall die. And if you say in your heart, 'How may we know the word that the Lord has spoken?' When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You need not be afraid of him." Don't miss it. If a prophet falsely claims to speak on behalf of God, he must die. But if his prediction doesn't come true, don't trust him. But we see this error happening again and again throughout church history. I don't have a contemporary example, but in the 1840s, there's a man named William Miller. He's just a farmer, worked in New York, self-taught in the Bible. He ended up traveling and preaching and teaching. From his study of Revelation, he predicted that Jesus would return sometime between 1843 and 1844. And there's a speculation related to Napoleon and the French Revolution that Napoleon was the Antichrist. He had ended the Roman Empire, setting off an uprising of eschatological expectation. So his first date was March 21, 1844. Nothing happened. As you know, we're all here. Miller returned to his study. Then he said, no, it's April 18, 1844, that Jesus would return. Even still, Jesus did not return. So he recalculated. Another date was set, October 22, 1844. Again, nothing happened. You can imagine there'd be some disappointment among him and his followers. I don't know who coined the phrase, but people call it the great disappointment. For us today, be cautious and discerning about self-proclaimed prophets today. Some make vague predictions that are hard to prove. Others make predictions about antichrists, blood moons, or the rapture. Just think about Agabus. His prediction wasn't really about the end times. It's about something coming, yes, about to happen. His prediction did not create panic or fear or hoarding. It increased the faith of the Antioch believers. And they financially helped the Jerusalem church. Now, when people make predictions today about hard times coming, people become afraid and self-centered. We don't have to think too far back to think of the toilet paper shortage during COVID. Maybe you had that here. We sure did in Canada. That's not of faith. In Antioch, the believers listened to true prophecy, and it caused a moment of faith, true generosity, and a show of love and unity between the churches and believers. So this church is growing into maturity, and giving money and aid was a huge step. It's no small act that Gentiles would support Jews without any hostility or animosity or racism. There's actually thanksgiving for the Jerusalem church as she suffers. There's also a recognized unity and equality. And we assume the Jerusalem elders, as they received the gift, there's no mention that they rejected it. We assume they received it and acknowledged God's work in Antioch. The center of Christianity is moving from Jerusalem to the north in Antioch. And this is where God will send his first official missionaries. God is not tied only to the land of Israel. His Spirit is going forth to all the nations. So I want to draw a few closing applications, five marks of a healthy church. What would the Holy Spirit want us to do in light of these verses? These five things are not meant to be a to-do list. Before we do anything, let's understand our identity as Christians. This is the first mark of a healthy church, that we belong to Christ. We see this in baptism when we identify with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. Jesus took our curse. He released us from punishment. He set us free so that we would live in resurrection power. So when you think of the word Christian, like that is who you are. And it's all made possible because of what Jesus did for us in his life and in his death. And we're incorporated into his life and death by faith and through baptism. We are in Christ. And so new life means we have a new name. And we need to be careful that we don't add unnecessary descriptors before Christian. We're just Christian. Now, I'll admit, sometimes I do add a name. Like I'm a white Christian, or my friends are Native or First Nation Christian. I don't think that's that sinful. But be careful of other descriptors that would take away from our identity in Christ. And as Christians, we also follow Christ. And that means we live distinctively like Jesus did. And we're going to have to swim against the cultural current of our age. And that's getting harder and harder. The second mark of a healthy church is we should spread the gospel. Now, this wasn't a plan or program of the early church. It didn't have an evangelism program. They didn't have a class. It simply happened. Evangelism is the outflow of being a Christian. And telling people of Jesus is one of the healthy building blocks of any church. We need to keep telling people. Now, we should do it as we sing. Good hymns, good songs tell us the gospel. And good preaching tells us the gospel. And then it naturally should come out of us through the week. Don't think of evangelism as something extra to add to the Christian life. We simply do it because it's who we are. See, I think that's where some evangelism classes and programs can get us all tied up in knots. I was that kind of person in Bible college. Because I thought I had to get through the whole outline in order to truly share the gospel. I realize now, no, one truth is good. One truth. And to listen to people and see where they're at. And there's no need to force. Although I will admit, I force the gospel if somebody's on their deathbed. They're going to hear the good news. And the good news isn't only good news for us. It's good news for all nations. In my community, some people think it's white man's gospel. It's only good for people of European descent. No. It's good for all nations. But as we spread the gospel, we're not guaranteed success. It won't always happen. So it's helpful to think of the parable of the sower. Not all the gospel seed actually even grew. And some that did come up quickly died just as quick. We're not guaranteed success. We are promised God's word will not return void. And that's hugely encouraging for me as I work in a tough culture. God will do his work. Be faithful. Spread the word. A third mark of a church, a healthy church, is that we need leaders. Sometimes a new leader needs to be brought in. Sometimes Fresh blood can really help a church. But it's also very healthy to develop leaders within the church. And what's healthy about the Antioch church is they had no founding pastor. I think that's a good thing. And I'm not against a pastor founding, you know, starting a church either. But you have no one in Antioch trying to be number one. They had a group of leaders. And even Barnabas, he's like, I can't do this alone. I need help. It's very healthy. And they're not going to stay there that long. By Acts 13, the Holy Spirit set apart Barnabas and Saul for Gentile missions. And they're gone. The church released them. I would think they would wrestle with that, but they let them go. Sometimes we need to pray long and hard for the Lord of the harvest to raise up leaders. Keep praying. Pray for my church too. We need leaders. A fourth mark of a healthy church is discipleship. Discipling believers. We need teachers because disciples need teaching. And we need teaching so we can be discerning about what's true. So we're not led astray. We also need encouragement to remain faithful to Christ. And God can use a variety of people to disciple us, from elders and deacons to just normal everyday Christians. If you think about your own Christian walk, you've probably had different people that encouraged you. They kind of played the role of Barnabas. I have all sorts of men that were like that. And also some older women that helped me. They were all Barnabas-like people. So you may have to seek them out, and that's okay too. God can use a variety of people to come alongside us and help us grow. Now, fifthly, as Christians, we can become givers. Now, what the Antioch church did wasn't the social gospel. It's actually an outflow of the gospel. Gentile believers owed their new life in Christ to the Jewish believers. And their generous gift promoted unity among the broader church. Because we know, Acts 15, there's difficulty between these Gentile believers. How are they going to fit? But some of them are taking good steps forward to try to help the church be unified. So for us, what we can do is use what we have to bless each other. Because we're mindful that we belong to another era, another kingdom. So we hold on to even our money loosely. Jesus warned us about the love of money. And we have to decide, am I going to love Jesus and his people the most? And if you do, it tends to release. And God can bless back too. I've had that so many times in my life. So in closing, we belong to Christ. So let's be willing to let others into our Christian circle. Sometimes that's actually hard. We have our group. We love each other. This church is really good at loving each other. I feel it. In many ways, you haven't changed a bit since we left many years ago. But sometimes it can be challenging to have a new person in, especially if they don't kind of look like us. They're different. But make room for new people. When we came here in 2004, you welcomed us with open arms. You did just that. You were like Barnabas to us. And I thank you for continuing to promote and support the Lord's work around the world, among the nations. So I just encourage you, keep growing in Christ. Keep living out what it means to be a Christian. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great things you've done. Thank you for your plan to reach the nations. Thank you for Jesus with his suffering and death, that he gives us life. And that, as Jesus said, he is the bread that came from heaven. He is spiritual food for lost and weary sinners. And thank you, Lord, that through the Holy Spirit, Jesus is carrying the Great Commission forward, and we can be a part of it. And we want to follow the Holy Spirit's leading as we live as Christians, as we tell others of Christ, and as we give generously, as you lead us. So Lord, we thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Rob. So great to have you and your family with us this morning. Part of coming together as believers is kind of a history lesson week in and week out. We turn to the book of Acts and we hear about the starting of believers coming together, Jews and Gentiles, the gospel going forth. We hear about the history of GBC and people have come through the doors and gone. And we're reminded of that as we fellowship together. And the amazing thing about it is it all centers on one story that we have all been brought into, the story of the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and how that has shaped our identity in such profound ways. It is what's brought us together. It's what sends us out. And it's what one day we will celebrate for all eternity with people from every tribe and tongue and from every nation. And so the Lord's Supper focuses us upon that central story. And it reminds us that we who were once far off from the grace of God have been brought near. It reminds us that we who were in debt because of our sin have been forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ. It reminds us that we are sons and daughters of God, that Christ is our older brother, and that we are brothers and sisters together who offer this message of grace to a world that so desperately needs it. And so this is a time that's for believers. Every Lord's Day, it's a reminder of the question, what are you looking to in life and in death? And for those of us who are trusting Christ, it is Christ's work and that alone. And if you're not sure the answer to that question and you're not sure that you're trusting in Christ, then I invite you to just see this as invitation into this amazing story of grace, that your sins can be forgiven simply by faith in Christ, that your identity can be forever changed by believing in the work that Jesus did on the cross for you. And so if that describes you, we ask that you not participate in this, but see what's going on as a visible invitation to come and to join in the riches of this feast of grace. For those of us who are believers, it's a time to be reminded of the grace and love that has been poured out upon us. And so as we respond to what we've heard of this great commission story, and as we consider this grace that has come to us, let's sing in response and in preparation, "Come to the Feast." It reminds us of what we have been invited to and are celebrating together this morning. And so you can find that printed here on page 11 in your bulletin. You can remain seated and we'll sing together, "Come to the Feast."
The great and the least, the
Let's pray and give thanks. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the invitation that we have received to come and to taste and see that you are good, and to taste and see especially your goodness for us in Christ. We're amazed that sinners like us have been welcomed into your family. We thank you that our Savior came and walked among people like us and brought this message of grace to Jews and to Gentiles, and how it has echoed down throughout the ages of a God who runs after sinners to redeem us, to forgive us, to welcome us into your family, and to give us the assurance of life forever with you, that we could know what we were created for, to be in relationship with you and enjoy you forever, together as your people, in a renewed heaven and a renewed earth. We confess that we are not worthy of any of these things, and so we say thank you. We pray that as we remember who we are this morning, as we fix our eyes on the sacrifice made for us by our Lord Jesus, that you would fill us with gratitude for your love for us. Would you strengthen our faith? Would you make strong our feeble knees and help us to renew our strength as we bring our weakness to you? Will you fill us with this message of good news for the neighbors you have brought into our lives, and how our hearts long for the salvation of those we love, and also those whom you have brought across our path who have yet to hear and believe the good news? We ask that you would work powerfully to send forth this word of grace, and that you would use us as well. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the Apostle Paul reminded us of the words of our Lord Jesus when he instituted the supper. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's eat together. And then in the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink together. Then he reminds us of those glorious things. He says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And one day our Lord Jesus will come again. And even so we say, "Come quickly, Lord Jesus." Amen. Well, as we have considered the work of Christ and how that message is going forth to all the nations. Our song of response this morning is, O Great God, and it reminds us of what the Lord has brought us through, and then it ends with a call and a prayer that we would live our lives going from this place dependent on that same grace that has brought us to faith as the Lord uses us wherever he may call us. And so I invite you to stand if you're able as we sing, O Great God, in response. Well, that is our prayer as we go, is that the Lord would be glorified through our lives. And the way he does that is by his grace. And so hear his words of blessing as you go. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and the steadfastness of Christ. You may go in that grace.